Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to everybody around the world, and welcome to the European HGS Pro League. My name is Sims, and we are in week number 4. Transfer period is now over. We've seen a few roster changes across both parts of the pond, and to be honest with you, Europe's kind of switched up, so honestly, anything could happen tonight. It's everything to play for in week number 4. Joining me on the desk, as ever, I have the fine and dandy, fantastic duo, Mr. Daniel Gaskin. And on the end, we have Mr. Harry Channon. Gentlemen, how are we feeling?
I'm great now. We're a duo. That makes me feel even better.
We were always a duo. Oh,
that makes me feel good.
Can you believe we were ever not a duo?
So did he just actually question your duo ability?
You did.
We were once teammates, so...
Oh yeah,
That was a thing that happened.
Yeah. Sorry, this is above the top 24 line. I don't step into that bracket. Yeah. But yeah, guys, we've got a fantastic show lined up. Obviously, transfer period is now over. Just before we dive into the teams, any initial thoughts how this week or this day is going to play out?
Honestly, I think it was a strange decision from U4X. We'll go into that later. I think the X-Men have probably benefited most from all these changes, just quickly.
Yeah, I'd agree. But at the same time, it's like we don't really know how the whole league's going to pan out now, because we don't know how these changes are going to impact these rosters, how they're going to play differently on certain maps. So everything we knew about the Pro League before, we kind of have to just kind of throw out the window, because we don't know how it's going to play out.
So we'll break it down right now through the HCS news and give you guys a quick rundown, a quick update of all the different things that have been going on. So you can see on screen there, EU rosters in turmoil. We've had some changes after the roster period. Of the teams are allowed to make one change during the summer season. The rosters are now locked for the remainder of the summer season. So we'll bring you the changes. First up, I do believe we have on screen U4X. Too foxy in, snaky out. Harry, break this one down, because I think we're all a little bit...
Okay, let me try my best. U4X, undefeated in the league, 6-0, only dropped one map. Apparently dropping one map was enough for them to say, hey, what? This isn't working out, guys. We need to drop a player, or we need to just separate from one of the players. And it is Snakey who was unfortunately switched out. They drafted in 2 Foxy from X-Men, one of my top 5 players in Europe. And... what do you got to say about that lineup? We've seen on paper this lineup really is pretty much the 4 best players in Europe right now. But we've said that before, haven't we, Sims? We've said that before about lineups. We've said that about the X-Men lineup when they were first put together. So we'll see if on paper it will actually play out as it should.
Well, kind of how you said then, obviously, the question is, and I'll put this one to you, Dan. We said before, was X-Men the European God squad that Europe was promised? Has that now changed to U4X?
It's one of these cases where if you've just got 4 really strong slayers in the team now, and you kind of need that, like Ramirez or the Snakey, the person that's going to get the job done, they're going to play that support role. And I think that's what Snakey did very well. So I think they will lack that in their team. So it will be a lot of pressure on Foxy's shoulders now coming into that team.
All right, then. So that is U4X. Let's move into X-Men to see how that one kind of leveled out. X-Men, Ramirez in, to Foxy out. So Foxy will move, as we mentioned before, into U4X. In comes Ramirez, someone that we always speak a lot about, I want to say, whether it's in a good side or a bad side, whether he's doing negative, whether he's going hugely positive, whether he's doing the dirty work, the teamwork. This man does it all. You get the full package with Rami, don't we? We spoke about, you were mentioning it over the Chalky duo.
Yeah, I mean, I think Ramirez hasn't attended an event without Chalky for about 4 years or something like that, last time I spoke to him. So it's great to see them back together, and I said before, you need that Ramirez on your team, and I think this X-Men lineup definitely needed that kind of player to just bring them to that next level, and I think that's what they were lacking, and maybe we might see the rise of the X-Men now.
Yeah, I actually really like this new X-Men team, because Ramirez is the kind of player who knows how to make his superstars shine. And that's what X-Men were. They were a group of 4 superstars who just didn't seem to have a direction. And I think Ramirez actually really brings that direction. Anyone who's been watching Jimbo's stream knows the type of communication and leadership that Ramirez is currently bringing to the X-Men squad. So I actually really like this acquisition by X-Men. I think it helps them out tremendously. And I think we're going to see maybe a bit of pressure taken off of Chalky and Jimbo, especially their shoulders, because now they've got Ramirez there leading the charge. They don't have to put as much emphasis on leadership within the game. I actually really like the new look X-Men.
So, obviously that's Ramirez. He left Team Vibe, as you can see there on screen in the bottom corner. We now see Snakey in to replace Ramirez. Snakey kind of coming off the backlash of what was the initial change. That's kind of what was the domino effect, kind of the lethal effect, I want to say, over in NA. Everything kind of spiraled out from them. Snakey, we heard various possibilities, no point in lying. We heard vicious rumors and things like that. But you know what? He's found a home in Vibe. You mentioned Snakey's that kind of player, Dan, who will, you know, it's kind of what you need, or get stuck in here, or get stuck in there, and do the dirty work no one has. However, my question to you is, we saw Vibe. They were getting better. As soon as we put Septic in there, we just injected, bang, some serious life. No disrespect to Speed whatsoever, but there was a definite noticeability with the whole team. They were getting better, and now they've found themselves probably on a team change they didn't, I think it's fair to say, they didn't expect. How does this leave Vibe now?
I mean, they didn't expect it to happen, but I think it might be a good one. You've now got three players that all attended Halo World Championships together in Riot, Lunny, and obviously Snakey now being added. So there's going to be natural chemistry there for these guys. So I'm really excited to see them kind of get underway.
I think it's a great upgrade now for Vibe. They look like a really solid squad, a very well-rounded squad now. Now that Septic is backfiring, we had some speculation because obviously he didn't play a lot after EMEAs. He's backfiring in the Pro League, and now they've kind of... I don't want to say upgraded their weak link, but it's fair to say that there were a lot of questions about Ramirez. You know, could he keep up in those vital game fours, game fives? He did last week on our broadcast, and obviously now he's moved on to Pastures New. But I actually really like the fact that Snakey is not just thrown in the towel. He's joined this Vibe team. Yes, they are in the relegation zone at the moment. They're down in that bottom two of the league. But I honestly think with this new acquisition, they could maybe sneak a few wins here and there, and maybe even make finals.
Let's take a look at the final team that made a change in Europe. Pulse, Punisher in, Crystallix out. Crystallix will step down, so we wish the best of luck to him and his endeavours in the future. Punisher, who was their recent sub, now takes a full-time slot for the remainder of the summer season. Obviously, a lot of questions were kind of around Pulse and, you know, what they were doing and how the kind of their ability, I want to say, within the Pro League. We definitely saw an improvement, though. You know, we saw the last change of... Go on, remind me again.
Solar quit.
Yep.
And we had Fragger come in.
Fragger comes in. Things start to get a little bit... Sorry, my mind's a blank.
That's all right.
Gets a little bit better. Now we bring in Punisher. Is this a good choice for them?
I think it adds more slaying power. I'm really excited to see it. I mean, I think that there's not really much more to be said except that there's just... They're getting better and better, Pulse. They're doing the right things, making the right changes.
Last time they made a change, they put a series on the board. And, you know, could it be 2 weeks in a row that they've made a change and they put a series on the board? They could even make it two wins here today. A lot remains to be seen about a lot of all these rosters. All these new rosters, we haven't seen them play. A lot of them, we don't know how they're going to play. We don't know what their strong game types are. We don't know their strengths. We don't know their weaknesses. So today is going to be a learning experience for us, as well as the teams and players now playing together for the first time.
And of course, it wasn't just Europe. We'll just leave it there because Dinosaurs and Infused, their rosters are locked, they're solid, no changes for them, they're the same teams. Harry's extremely happy because we've heard of a few rumours, but you know what, the teams are moving forward. Let's move across to NA and take a quick look at that one. Rostermania in NA, negative. We did not see a spiral roller coaster, kind of what we've seen in previous season and initially in previous times, especially with the whole lethal thing, because that just went wild. However, we do see two team changes. We see Dinoxide coming in for Assault on Liquid, and we see Hines taking up Goofy's spot in Allegiance. Hines, you say the name, there's nothing else to say. It's Richie Hines at the end of the day, and he'll bring a hell of a lot to that team Allegiance. Obviously, best of luck to every single player that leaves the Pro League in every single way. And yeah, that's pretty much rounds it up for the team change across the board. One thing that I want to mention finally, out of all the news today, hitch your skin, stay tuned for the North American Pro League show. Boys and girls, ladies and gentlemen, we have got some incredible things to show you. We're not going to speak about it on here. However, stay tuned. You do not want to miss. Honestly, there'll be watch your Twitter feeds, watch the stream. Things are happening. Things are coming. We'll get a preview. Looking forward to it. Things are good, guys. We've got we're rolling on, rock and roll, summer season. We're coming up to the end of it now, weeks 4 and 5. Then we'll go to the relegation and finals. Everything's kind of heating up. I don't know about you, but I'm super looking forward to getting this underway.
Yeah, definitely. And obviously, we'll look at the standings later, but I think U4X can secure their spot in finals today if they get a win. Everywhere else, it's still to play for. Even Pulse can still make finals. Mathematically.
Yeah, there's also quite a lot of congestion in the middle of the table at the moment. I think later on today we have Vibe versus Infused, if I'm not mistaken. If Vibe beat Infused, then they basically leapfrog them in the league, I'm pretty sure. I think it comes down to map percentage, but I think both of those teams would be 3-3 in the league. So some very vital matchups here still to come late on in the season, guys. I'm looking forward to them. I just can't wait to get them underway.
Right, let's crack on then and give you guys at home who are just joining us for the first time a rundown of how the European Pro League will work out. Summer season on your screen now. Top six teams advance to the European qualify for the league. All teams play each other twice during the season. Top four teams advance to the season finals. Fifth and sixth place drop down to relegations to fight it off against the open circuit teams. Quick reminder, fifth place in this league will get to choose and determine their challenger from the open series. Sixth place will have to play whoever is left. Let's take a look at all the teams then and how we are now standing here, ladies and gentlemen, for the remainder. Jimbo, Snipe Drone, Chalky, Ramirez, Makeup, X-Men, Respectful, Moz, Too Foxy and Kimbo are U4X. Batchford, Flux, Warlord, Doodle remain untouched, and that is Team Infused. Move across to the blue corner. We have Cali, Punisher, SLG, and Fragger. That makes up Pulse Gaming. Book 20, Mr. 57, Flames, and Cristola are the dinosaurs. And finally, we have Vibe, Snakey, Lunny, Riot, and Team Captain Septic. We have some incredible, credible teams. Let's take a look at how they are currently stood within the European League. Running down from 1 to 6, U4X, Infused, X-Men, Dinosaurs, and Vibe and Pulse Gaming, unfortunately, out the bottom in the red area. The red area is the danger zone, and by the end of week 5, you do not want to find yourself in that bottom 2 because you will be going to relegation. You will not be making it to the finals. Dan, any kind of quick word of what you're seeing there?
I just think, as I said earlier, it's all to play for. Pulse, they've still got potential of making that finals. If Vibe were to lose today, though, to Infused, and then suddenly lose tomorrow, we're looking at everything being decided by tomorrow. Next week, we might already have our top four finalists.
Interesting stuff. Okay, moving on to our next section. We want to take a quick look at how this one's going to be planning out today. Dinosaurs versus U4X, game number one. And what a day, what a way to crack off the game number one, because that is going to be a hell of a matchup. I do believe, Harry, you think that Dinosaurs, am I right in saying this? Dinosaurs have the best chance against them?
Yeah, I said last week that I think Dinosaurs probably the team to take down U4X. And since I said that, Dinosaurs actually went 0-2 last week. So I think Cristola said, you know, we took a week off practicing. We can't really afford to do that anymore. We know we have to buckle down and practice for every single game in this league. So I'm expecting to see a more improved Dinosaurs this week. Can they take down U4X? Not really too sure. I think we're going to see that now. In my opinion, I'd put my money on U4X, but Dinosaurs did not make a change during the transfer period. U4X did. So that may just play into the favour of the Dinosaurs.
Speaking of another team that didn't make a change during transfer, Infused will take on Vibe. Important game for Vibe if they want to really stamp their foothold on the European Pro League. And then finally for game number 3 at the end of the day, we will see X-Men taking on Pulse Gaming. Can Pulse Gaming, the French monsters, fight back against the new lineup of X-Men? It'll be a nice challenge for both sides as they are with both new players. Take a look at day number 2. This, of course, will be the player streams and onsets community cast. Pulse Gaming versus Dinosaurs, Infused versus X-Men, and then down at the bottom we have Vibe taking on U4X. And the one thing I have to say when I look at all these matches, I just look at how many people are kind of ex-teammates and been playing against one another and really know how each other work. And again, we didn't see any real, apart from Pulse, newcomers, so to speak, within the UK teams. Everyone's just kind of switched up. So things looking extremely, extremely good. We're just about to get game number one underway. We're looking for the eye in the sky. We've been told that the players are locked, loaded, and ready to go. So let's bring up the teams on screen and show you guys who exactly is going to be fighting out in game number one. Dinosaurs versus U4X. I mean, you know the people on the rosters, you know the teams, you know how things are going to play out. Let's take a look at the best of five series and see how this one's going to run through. Harry, give us a look at the maps.
So game number one, we have Fathom, Capture the Flag, and game two, Colosseum Slayer. Game number three will be Eden Strongholds, then games 4 and 5, back-to-back Truth, if they are needed, Capture the Flag, game number 4, and Truth Slayer, game number 5.
One thing we actually said, Dan, you mentioned this when you were doing the vetoes this week. These, across the three series that we've got a good variety of maps.
We definitely do, and teams are definitely kind of seeing what are the best maps for the other teams. I think Dinosaur specifically didn't want to play Plaza against U4X. I think in day two as well, their opposition didn't want to play Plaza against U4X. So they've cited out these maps and said, look, we're not playing this. We know they're good on it. We've seen them perform well on it. So they're learning this veto system, and they're definitely trying to use it to their advantage.
And of course, there is kind of a little bit of, I want to say, a meta that's starting to, you know, unfold. And I think when you look at the teams, we're starting to see this kind of pattern of certain teams will watch what their opponent picks to see if they kind of remove something that the opposing team's good at, or will choose which maps that they are good at. And we're kind of starting to really see this one break down now. And honestly, I mean, initial thoughts, Fathom CTF, who's for you, who's this kind of running favour of?
I mean, was it week two when we saw that dinosaur, that flag cap for Dinosaurs to win 3-2 on Fathom CTF? They definitely know what they're doing on this map, but U4X are just looking so strong right now. It will just really come down to how well 2Foxy fits into this lineup.
All right then, guys, capture the flag on Fathom. Three captures will win. This is game number one, day number one, week number four. We are fresh out of the transfer period. Ladies and gentlemen, tweet the stream. Use the hashtag HCS. And as also, if you are a streamer as well, feel free to host us. Just type /hosthalo in your chat, and that will help boost the figures throughout the Halo community. Kicking things off with no other than 2Foxy, the new addition to the team.
Yep, grabbing the battle rifle straight away. A great weapon to grab just so you can look across that map and finish anyone off. If anyone does get any shots, as he does onto Buck 20, pushes for the camo. Unable to take down Cristola though, but his teammate's there to clear things up. Great control of the top mid early on from 2Foxy.
And that's where you want to be. Time and time again, we see on Fathom people just not only controlling top mid, but controlling the game. No one watching that gen spawn, so 57's going to come out. We'll take on 2Foxy, goes 1-1, doesn't decide to challenge, which I like. He's going to back off, does live, and actually it's going to be he will get the kill, so good place from Will.
And that's the big difference, really. I mean, would you have seen Snakey making that play, jumping into the base and being aggressive and challenging the opponents? You're going to see these different types of playstyles from 2Foxy, and it's really going to depend how the team kind of molds around his playstyle. He really needs to look at what they're doing and kind of mold around them rather than them mold around him.
I think we have to say U4X 100% have the slaying advantage. This is a very strong, very aggressive and very determined team, but the things that we've seen out of Dinosaurs, no one, you know, I don't want to say we underestimated them, but they're not dead, they're not extinct, they've been putting on some good shows, and of course the practice is there. Respectful will come from behind, grabs the perfect kill on Buck 20 as well. Doesn't actually see anybody to his right. We can see on the player outlines he's got one running left, one running right. Will take down Flames with a quick beatdown, whips out the AR, and of course if you're going to go toe-to-toe with somebody, that's the kind of weapon you want in the hand. Now he's going to hang around back. He will run in to try and block this gen spawn so no one's in there. There is someone in there. We're a little bit too late. Grenades will come in. There's going to be no hit markers on that. However, he will have someone spawning in the base as well, so he will fall.
I've got to say, marvellous patience as well from Respectful. He kind of got a kill and then backed off rather than just aggressively charging. Sometimes you'll get a kill and just push as much as you can. He was very patient about his play and he got a few kills because of it.
I've swapped over Flames here because in the next 10 seconds or so, the camouflage is coming up. I was going to say he had beautiful top middle control, but instead he's ducked down for that railgun. That camouflage is coming up very, very soon. Flames can't quite get the kill, so I'm going to swap over to someone who's actually running the flag right now. Interesting note about this game type, guys. It was actually this map and this game type is the only map and game type that U4X have dropped so far in the league. They lost a Pulse on this game type 3-1.
Interesting stuff. Did not know that. Let's see if Dinosaurs can also take control and maybe, just maybe, put a win and a point on the board. Unfortunately, Cristola will drop down. He's got the railgun in his hand as well. It's going to fall on the floor, I do believe. But you know what? Kimbo will switch to third person mode. See who's behind him. Nobody is near him whatsoever. That's a 3-run and possibly even a stealth capture. Yes, it is. Not a single person took a shot. I mean, and that's kind of screams volumes about this U4X roster. And we see Kimbo being that objective player time and time again. He'll happily just run in, grab a flag, and he knows he's safe and sound in the back pockets of his teammates and their slaying capabilities.
And the thing is, U4X just waited. They said, look, we'll let you make the first move. Dinosaurs pulled a flag in Cristola. Cristola then, he hit a wall of U4X. And they said, look, okay, now we're going to slay you. The flag's out. We're just going to get a counter cap. And fantastic run there from Kimbo as well. The fact that no Dinosaur player was even able to see him means that they were well on top of spawn control.
2Foxy's going to grab himself a BR. He knows it's kind of up. inside the little gap area as he looks for some players, finds one down on the blue vat. Take a look at the kill feeds there. That's a 57 who's on top at the moment with a golden arrow with 9 kills in the back. Will catch Flames off guard. They will trade out. There's a double, so two are going to be down. Moses up top mid. Respectful's going to try and stop the flag pull, but unfortunately 57 will give him a quick jawline and down he goes. In comes his brother Buck 20. Will save the day as he stops Moses and possibly even go for a double. Doesn't quite land it. That means the flag is still out, but it's just all but returned.
Yeah, these dinosaurs are more than happy to be pulling flags, though. They want to get on the aggressive, but I think that might play into the hands of U4X just because of the raw slaying power that this team does have. So we see 57 just kind of controlling top mid, and top mid obviously being very important because of that camo, which should be up any time now, as the railgun also drops as well.
Interesting pull by the flag guy. He definitely did have some support there. As we see a flagnum kill, he's going to come in. We'll see two Foxy, two players, and Moz as well. Even if he's just been annoying, can't get that last kill. That'd have been pretty big for him. However, Flames comes in with a grenade to take him down as well. Now we see Buck 20 on the defensive with the railgun, just waiting for that flag to come back. I actually didn't see the flag has gone in, so now we're at 1-1. Buck 20 has top mid control, didn't land the shot. He's probably going to get chased here. In fact, no, we'll see a U4X player will back off to the treehouse.
One thing that's very surprising in this game for me, Sims, is the fact that dinosaurs are going toe-to-toe in slays here with U4X. That entire flag cap pretty much just came off dinosaur kills in the kill feed, and it was just fantastic execution by them. They tie up the game 1-1.
The dinosaurs are definitely capable of the slaying power. They've got Cristola, who is just an absolute monster. I mean, he's been described as the new Jimbo. I know we say it every week, but you cannot ignore that man. If he gets behind you, if he even takes you on with a battle rifle fight, he's probably going to win, as we do see Cristola winning the assault rifle fight against the man himself, Moz.
And that's the kind of... I think I did actually see a couple of pistol bullets coming in the back of Moz then, and for a player like Moz, and respectful when you look at them and how tanky they are and how much of a powerhouse we've seen their abilities before to survive, you really do want to be shooting these players down. And when you're in a position like top mid, you really want to get Moz out of there, because if he starts grabbing camo, keeping that off the spawn, getting the time perfectly, you are going to be in all sorts of trouble. Now we see Flame stepping up. Will try and spin around to get a beat down off. It was a good attempt. Unfortunately, didn't quite land it. Kimbo will see it through as we now move across to Cristola, who's pushing hard on Blue Treehouse.
One thing I've definitely noticed more is there's a lot more individual battles coming out of this U4X side. I mean, the U4X of old, when they had Snakey, it used to always be at least two people getting in your face. At the moment, they seem to be running around like individuals. I don't know whether that's just the addition of Foxy, just the aggression. They're trying to get all over the map, trying to get in the faces of the dinosaurs. But dinosaurs, like you said, really going toe-to-toe at the moment and bringing it to this new U4X side.
I really like where he run the flag, because he knew they were spawning over by the treehouse. He actually decided to run it straight through bottom mid. In comes 57 from behind. They've got defensive. Someone's inside the base. I can't remember which player is next to him, but he does have one of his teammates who's got the railgun, so that'll be a big kill if they can go down, take him down. Three are in the base now. We're going to see Respectful try to just get a little bit of position up on that top middle section. They get the return. 2-1. We're now seeing dinosaurs going one flag cap up on U4X. Harry, what is going on?
Well, I've got to say, I really don't know. This new U4X team, looking very, very shell-shocked right now. I was about to touch on the fact that dinosaurs actually 2-0 on this game type. They are undefeated on Fathom Capture the Flag so far in the league.
Can we take a quick look at the kill feed just to show people at home what the kind of... Have they been outslayed at this moment in time? I think they are indeed. Flames, 20 kills, Respectful only on 9. At the moment, the dinosaurs are well and truly in control of this map. 57, unfortunately, will drop, and so will Cristola. It's going to be 2 down. This probably will be a dead flag. I really don't want to see Buck 20 overextend. However, in comes Flames out of nowhere. Will get a touch, but there's only one more person alive. His teammates are coming off the spawn through the garage. Unfortunately, a few needless deaths, in my opinion.
I mean, I like the attempt of throwing the flag to Flames. I mean, if 20 was able to survive after that flag touch, they might have been able to get it in, but unfortunately, U4X are going to regain a bit of map control because of this, because of those good grenades off spawn, as we now seeing U4X are moving a flag on the kind of counter cap, and it's Kimbo again moving the flag. I'm not used to seeing Kimbo doing all this objective work. Clearly, he's having to kind of jump into this role. Now they've added two Foxy.
Well, he does shut down one. 57 hasn't turned around. He's got Moz up there causing him all sorts of problems. Hopefully, he can grab that kill, which he does not. Moz will sit him down, so Moz causing problems up in the top middle section and really keeping him out of there. However, two players just collapsing in on the blue base. Kimbo is forced and is pushed backwards. Grenade goes in, just waiting for that flag guy to come out. He still hit markers. Really timed that absolutely perfectly and read it so well. Cristola also gets the bad end of a bullet. Double kill for Kimbo. He's in a fantastic position at the moment. He's just stopping this dinosaur's push.
And this is what U4X need to do. They need to get that top control. They just need to try and outslay this Dinosaur Squad. At the moment, they're trying to take them toe-to-toe. They're trying to take these 1v1s rather than these 2v1 situations.
Flames is doing pretty much a lot of the work here for Dinosaurs. He has the most kills in the game and also the most returns. That one flag return pretty much came off all of Flames' movement. He just pushed straight in for the flag, won a duel, and got the return. Great plays from Flames so far in this game.
As we take a look at the map now, though, there's three people inside that base. Down goes one, and they're kind of just getting collapsed in on. They're getting trapped like mouse in a mice trap at this moment in time. Kimbo, three people in there. He'll get one kill, and all of a sudden, the flag's back on the move. He's going to take this the top middle section. He's got Respectful for some support cover. I really want to see Respectful try and be more aggressive on the treehouse. One player will opt to drop the flag and try and run away and survive. Unfortunately, that's not good enough. But you know what? Railgun's coming in. Flames once again, Harry, every single time. Buck 20, unfortunately, gets shut down and says no. He does get a touch, though. That flag is just outside the window. They really need to kind of use it as bait at the moment in time and just get stop these poles. I think it's going to be a little too late. We see Kimbo flying in. All of a sudden, down, we're tied up 2-2.
We are tied up, but I think that's three, maybe four down. If Buck 57 can survive, he can. Perry spawned, Two Foxy spawned there, was able to take him down. Very patient play, actually, from Two Foxy that we saw. He watched the flag. He waited. The opposition kind of ran in. I think it was Buck 20, and he was there just to clean him up.
Yeah, it seems like U4X have actually woken up so far in this game. We're seeing less slays out of Dinosaurs in the kill feed, and U4X, as a result, were able to put a flag on the board. But just as I say that, three of the U4X members do go down, so let's swap over to Cristola here and see if he can help his team fashion this flag run.
If we just reverse for just a second and kind of talk about what happened there, as we saw the Dinosaurs did get a pull on the flag, but nobody actually stepped in the base. It was a bit of a desperate pull, I want to say, because nobody was in the base to stop that gen spawn whatsoever. So as soon as Foxy came out of spawn, he was just in their face, shut it down. But you know what? These grenades are coming in thick and fast. Throws in a... Oh, Splinter doesn't get any hit markers, finds any targets, but you know what? He's going up behind him. Can he get this kill? That'd be huge if he did. That's two down. Great trade-off.
I mean, this Dinosaur Squad definitely has a game plan. Get in the face, pull the flags, and then we'll just work from there. They're not controlling spawns that well, but they're definitely looking at where players are spawning. The trouble is with this Dinosaur Squad, when they do have the lead, when they've got that 2-1 advantage, when they've got that kind of 1-0 advantage going into 2 minutes left, they don't really know what to do, whether to sit back or whether to attack. We've seen it in past weeks. Now at 2-2, I think it's actually better for them than being 2-1 up with 2 minutes left.
There's a lot of pressure on Dinosaurs, especially as we see U4X closing in on the prey. But Cristola's in quite an unorthodox spot. He's just going to run through the courtyard and just really run straight head on into two of them. We'll get an assist with 57 and takes down Mose as well. Now 57 is just going to try and look for anybody who's going to try and climb up through the opposing treehouse. He knows he has a little bit of support, though, from his teammate who's on the left of him. Grenades are going in thick and fast. We're not seeing any hit markers. And just as we kind of look across the board, probably about their 25%. At the moment in time, U4X are kind of locked back into their side. Grenade will go down. Unfortunately, Respectful's map movement is just too damn good. Thrust out of the way of the nade and will survive another day.
U4X clearly made a decision. Look, let's just sit back. Let's let them come to us. Then we'll slay them and then we'll push. And I think it was a good decision. They just kind of created a wall. They kind of crossed sight lines. They were just checking every angle. And the Dinosaurs just walked into a barrage, an ambush almost. And now we see the U4X on the offensive.
Anyone see that splinter? Respectful just threw it, bounced it off the wall and banked it into the back of someone's head. Now go toe-to-toe with Buck 20. We'll get that as he gives him the bunt end of a gun. 57's also in the open. He'll be no shields whatsoever, trying to get some support from his teammates, but two of them are in the bottom middle section. It's a bit of a death zone at this moment in time. He does get a kill from the grids. That's quite important because that's a damn good trade-off.
And Cristola was there. He flanked around. He made sure that that flag didn't get captured. Fantastic individual play from him. You don't often see individual plays as often in Halo 5, but when they come, boy, did the players shine.
A little bit of an unfortunate kind of windmill, I want to say, from Mose there. I think that was possibly four shots with the BR he missed on that one-shot guy, and then he died afterwards. Kimbo, great thrust back, though. Managed to stay alive and get a beatdown off before he went down. Now we'll see Flames just kind of slowing it down a little bit. Will be too late as Mose grabs himself. That's camo. It would have been an important kill to take down and burn the camo guy. However, Cristola, you see there on the assist medal at the bottom, takes down Mose. Double kill as well for Cristola. He's in a really cracking position as well. There's only two players in the both at the treehouses.
I can just imagine Cristola sitting there listening to everything, not speaking that much, but just running around and looking at everything that his teammates are shouting. He just seems to be getting all the kills, seems to be finishing off everything. He's a fantastic player to have on your side, but someone really needs to step up now. So you're going to be looking at players like Cristola, like Buck20, to be making moves and trying to get these kills.
That would have been an insane kill if it had managed to land that nade at the side and just take down. But 1, 2, 3, I've just seen a kill feed of U4X coming up on the side. Guys, we are now into overtime. The next cap, of course, wins. If this is 2-2 at the end of this 1 minute 46, we will have a full replay in effect. Kimbo looking over at 2Foxy, just checking that he is safe. Now we'll drop a nade down bottom mid. Unfortunately, it's not good enough. It's a big trade-off at least. Flames is trapped in the corner. We'll take down one. That's respectful as we see 2Foxy just coming to try and get this return. Flames pokes back out. But unfortunately, Foxy's shot is just too damn dominant.
Yeah, Foxy just kind of defending as he can as his team is trying to push this flag in. But the Dinosaurs have managed to overrun the U4X base. They pulled a flag out. They can get a return as well. Then we're going to be back to a standoff, I would have thought.
That's a massive pull by Moz, though. He runs straight from the vat. Whoever's actually running this down the bottom midsection, I think they're pretty generous, to be honest with you, because they just had a go at it, but unfortunately it's not good enough. U4X to game number one, 3-2. But my word, Dinosaurs putting on a show. I can only imagine Snakey sat at home right now and smiling to himself just a little bit. Harry, run us through what you've seen on the kill feed.
230 bombs out of Respectful and Moz, 2 caps out of Kimbo, and actually that's 6 flag returns. That's pretty unorthodox we've actually seen there out of 2Foxy. 6 returns on the other side. Flames, 31 kills, 21 out of 20. It's not really good enough, to be honest with you. And I tell you what, though, it was actually a close game. It did go to overtime, but you've got to think, if Buck20 can maybe get a few more kills in that game, then maybe the flag game swings the other way.
One thing I want to say from that, as we actually count up, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 flag returns out of U4X. I really feel like, and I don't know about yourselves here, that's Dinosaurs just constantly pressurizing them and really putting the backs up against the wall. And Harry called it perfectly, a bit unorthodox for you 2Foxy to be constantly chasing them down. Do you think it was just pure pressure then, or beginner's luck?
Dinosaurs had a game plan. We're just going to keep pulling flags and we're just going to slay as we go. And it was working. I think the game just needed to kind of, it got too far for Dinosaurs. U4X kind of, they woke up a little bit. They didn't come out of the blocks hot. They were a bit cold, they're a bit stale. You saw Moz, you saw Respectful struggling with kills. When they started to pick it up, that's when the U4X squad really started to get good.
Yeah, we saw here the early aggression of Dinosaurs time and time again, getting in the base and pulling the flag. This right here, I think Flames actually just charged in, made him weak, and Buck20 was able to not only catch the flag, he also threw the nade and took down the player that Flames was charging as well. But overall, just a really great performance out of U4X. They did have to bounce back in the game. They came back from 2-1, and again, Kimbo here, top middle control, just great listening, cleaning up players left, right, and centre, and it was just a fantastic job here out of U4X.
I mean, we said it's unorthodox for Foxy to get those flag returns, but I don't think flag returns is necessarily like an objective kind of thing. I think 2Foxy was just getting in their face. He was being aggressive. He was slaying as he does, and he was like, oh, well, I can return a flag while I'm killing them all, so why not? So that's what he was doing, and I was a bit unsure at first, but I definitely warmed to this 2Foxy in U4X after that kind of final few minutes of the game.
And do you know what?
What?
Got Moz in my fantasy squad.
Oh.
Yeah, boys. Yeah.
Wait, who do I have? Kimbo. Yeah, I've got Kimbo.
Who have you got?
I got Respectful, and he was only 3 kills behind him, so
bad.
I'm okay with that. That's fine.
You see, to be fair, I can imagine now, because Moz were a little bit behind last week, he's probably just going to stat pad like a bad man.
One thing
week.
I've noticed, though, about Respectful, his fantasy stats are off the charts when he's on the official... When he's on the official stream. So on day one, so when he's on our broadcast, he goes off. He always has decreased stats in the next day. I can't tell whether or not it's because he's a big-time player or whether or not, you know, it's just complete freak.
We need to, like, keep racking up these questions because we're going to have him on after the show. Yeah. Hopefully he's not got his Skype mobile out with his... doing his air like this, as we know
selfie
he does.
Selfie stick.
What's
going on, boys? Want to get a KFC?
Well, I'm from Scunthorpe Town. You know it. But yeah, we're going to have him on after the show, so be good to speak to Brandon, see how this team's going on, because we haven't really heard much from him so far. We haven't had him on the stream. Moving in to game number two. If you had just joined us, welcome along to week number four, day number one. Let's take a quick look at the scores from the previous game, as we just saw a 3-2 win by U4X. No one kind of expected Dinosaur. Actually, saying that, you did. You said that Dinosaurs would pull a pretty good fight. Do you think this is going to roll into game number two, or do you think that we're kind of, you know what, boys, we're taking it easy, it's time to wake up?
It's an interesting one, game two, because U4X haven't played Colosseum Slayer, which is game two. They haven't played Colosseum, period. in the Pro League.
Really?
They have yet to play Colosseum, I'm pretty sure. I might be mistaken on that one, but I'm 99% sure we haven't seen U4X on any day in the Pro League play on Colosseum.
Was this, you might remember this one, is this the turnaround map for Dinosaurs when they played X-Men?
Yes, it is. They won 50-45 on Colosseum Slayer in game number 5.
What do you think about this? Do you think this could be the turnaround?
I don't think Dinosaurs need to turn anything around right now. I think they just need to keep doing what they're doing. If they play like that, they're in every chance of winning a Slayer game. I just think they were unlucky with their flagpoles. They got countercapped probably twice in that game. Just how that map can go sometimes. You can just be on the receiving end or you can be on the giving end.
Hindsight's a wonderful thing.
Yes.
Do you possibly think maybe there was a little bit too much YOLO pulling, I want to say?
Well, it's kind of a double-edged sword because if your team get the kills and you are in position to run that flag early, then a lot of the time it's going to be a cap because most of the time you don't need to slay those second wave of spawners because the flag is already on the move.
Yeah.
But at the same time, if your team don't get the kills and you die, then more than likely their team is already in your base pulling your flag. So it's kind of like, like you said, it's a YOLO play. It's pretty risky. And Dinosaurs were playing a risky game there. It went well for them in the first half of the game. They went 2-1 up, but unfortunately U4X just had the resilience to come back.
So moving into game number 2, we have Colosseum Slayer, as mentioned. This, of course, was the Dinosaurs reversal game. They came back against X-Men and pretty much pulled off a show that nobody expected. Eden Strongholds will be game number 3. And then back-to-back, Truth Capture the Flag and Truth Slayer. I'm a big fan of Truth, so I'm glad we're getting 2 games back-to-back. But I very much doubt we will see a best of 5. I think we may see a game 4. If not, I really think U4X are just going to turn up the heat here. And we're going to see some dinosaur meat at the barbecue, boys. I've got this feeling that that's it now.
What does dinosaur taste like?
You never had dinosaur before? Beef. Never ate a lizard before?
No.
Neither have I.
Okay. So right then. Okay.
Right, we're moving to the game. We've been told the lobby is just about to get underway. Of course, U4X wins against Dinosaurs, you can see down there. Remember, gents, ladies, everyone at home, please, please, please tweet the stream. Let everyone know what is going down today. This is week 4, of course, coming fresh off of that transfer period. We're currently kind of on board with Foxy, looking at how he is working with this U4X roster. Can he make them stronger, or will we see a little bit of a change from game number 1? The pressure certainly looked on for U4X, but hey, we can't knock Dinosaurs.
Hey.
If it's not broke, hey, don't fix it.
I'm glad that some of the teams didn't make changes. Dinosaurs, Infused, especially Infused, because they're kind of a young lineup and it's good to see them stick together. But we'll talk about that later. The Dinosaur squad, there's so much potential there.
Yeah.
I mean, the Bucks are 2 of the most successful players in Europe. Combine that with your ex-coach, who knows everything about you, and this new young raw talent of Cristola. I mean, he's been grinding Halo since, like, Halo 3, but only really came into the scene at, like, Halo 2 Anniversary. And now he's finally on a top roster, and it's really good to see these young guys kind of coming through the scene.
You guys have seen him, obviously, at previous LAN events. Did he kind of, back when you were casting them together, was he kind of a standout player as such when you've seen him?
Who's this, sorry?
Cristola.
Cristola, yeah. Him and Flames tend to work together very, very well. They always seem to be flying together. They have very similar play styles in the fact that they're very aggressive. And when you combine them with the Bucks, they're a very solid foundation to build off. That's why I really, really like this Dinosaurs team. And in fact, I think I might start this game off with someone from Dinosaurs. Let's start this one off with Cristola.
All right then, guys. Rock and roll on board with Cristola now. Game 2 is underway. Collie Slayer is the name of the game. Getting to first to 50 points is the aim. Cristola finds Perry. Going to turn up down in the maze. Moses round the corner. You can see on the player outlines. He's just going to throw that grenade. Will get no hit marker, so still doesn't know where he is. I like this play, though. He's going to go up behind him. He don't know where he is. He's just seen him on the radar, but he's going to stay alive, which I absolutely like. There's a guy there with Rocky. He's not entirely sure how this one's going to play out. He will finally get the kill, so Flames will live with the noob tube. Can he get this kill? No, he cannot, unfortunately, but he's patient. However, he hasn't seen the player hiding on the pyramid.
And if we whisper, maybe he won't see him. Nope, he is going to see him, but Cristola will take him down. Cristola is like one of these players. He's just like a slippery fish. And I think you need a slippery fish on every team. Someone that's just going to wibble and wobble around your back lines and just be an absolute nuisance. And as we see, Moe's, he's that type of player as well. So they're the kind of guys you could be watching in this game. See if they can get behind those back lines. See if they can take out the snipers if someone's got a sniper and stuff like that.
That's the one thing about Moe's. I know you can say things about people's map movement being truly incredible, but it's his position more than anything. He's always in the most unorthodox places and in areas that you just wouldn't expect and just sometimes forget to check. Quite interesting to see what happened with two foxes. We see just a little skull of death coming up there, so that was a suicide somewhere along the line. 10-5 though, double the scoreline at the moment for Dinosaurs. They're coming out of the gates rather hot. We'll scope in across to the pyramid section. There's two foxes. If we look left and right, we can see Kimbo coming up on the elbow approach. Perfect kill from 20. We'll sit him back down. Now three people though, Dan, boxed in down at the sniper section.
Yeah, at the moment, Dinosaurs are a little bit all over the place, and U4X are just going to swarm and take advantage of that. I'm a little bit concerned by the lack of slaying power from U4X, considering they have probably four of the best slayers in Europe right now. But I think it's just a case of chemistry and gelling. All they need to do is get one series on board, and then suddenly, they're in the finals.
And then, within seconds, they're now back in the lead. As you were going through that, Dan, I actually watched the kill feed, and it's just gone from strength to strength. Every single kill pretty much has been U4X, 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 and it's just racking up now. He knows exactly where this player is. Downstairs in the basement, we'll clean that one up with ease. Kimbo knew the rockets were coming up. He took control of that entire rocket side. He did originally go up, but got sat down with the perfect kills we saw earlier on, but he definitely wanted some revenge.
Yeah, I'm seeing a bit of a hard counter coming here out of the Dinosaurs. We see U4X putting a lot of emphasis on this sniper tower where Kimbo is right here, the green tower. We always see a Dinosaurs player. We saw Buck20 for a large majority of the start of this game, and Cristola now at the top of the rockets. There seems to be a bit of a hard counter here to this kind of sniper control setup that we're seeing a lot out of U4X, excuse me.
Yeah, and I think it's just because of that carbine addition up there. You can now just got so much more reason to push that rocket place. You don't have to worry about when rockets are going to be up. You can push there, grab carbine. It's a great vantage point. You can shoot across to the sniper side of the map.
So I'm going to be looking around a 30 to 35 section. As every, generally speaking, whenever we watch high-end level Halo, that's kind of the rough guesstimate time of when one team starts to really take a lead and turn up the heat, and then you see the gap and the scoreline really advancing. Great position though, he wants to be in, he's in the corner, unfortunately does miss the initial shot, doesn't matter, whips out his Magnum, will seal the deal, but you know what, he doesn't get away lightly. U4X box him in, Kimbo sees the sniper rifle, and he's just going to go dive bomb straight for that, unfortunately. he'll take a couple of splinter nades just for a good laugh as well, but it doesn't matter, he's still alive. Only a one kill game though, Dan, everything neck and neck.
Yeah, and it's going to be a case of one of these teams actually setting up with this sniper and allowing one player to just go off. They are favouring this kind of cave setup with the sniper at the moment because they know the opposition is going to be pushing from sniper. But personally, I like that kind of rocket elbow position because you get such a clear view of the map. But you're definitely going to take different map kind of rotations when you know the sniper is up. You're just going to be avoiding those typical sight lines.
This will trade for the third time now when we find it back in the hands of its original owner of the Dinosaurs. Just checking the S3 section, make sure nobody's there. He doesn't have much in the form of defense, so he needs to be extremely careful. We'll get away with the rockets. This will be a good kill for Buck20 if he can get it. Unfortunately, he cannot. You really don't want to let Moz live. There's one. Oh, he just had to reload. Otherwise, he could have scoped in. He's going to back off, though, because he knows they're going to be spawning on his side where he was because his teammates are over in the side of blue. However, one teammate is going to help him and come and get that initial kill, give him the support that he needs, and now he can set up in what I like to call the snipe drone corner.
I mean, there are a few questionable shots there from Buck20. He's not warmed up right now. We saw him struggling game one, but I love the rotation with the sniper rifle. He rotated with his team spawning, made sure that he's not going to give it away. The sniper is how they're going to win this game or lose this game, so they need to be really careful not to give it away.
He's possibly advancing just a little bit too much for my liking, especially when you're up on the maze, because you can get shot from both sides of the maze and then down below. He's actually going to stick a splinter nade to someone's head, and I have no idea how he managed to stay alive from that one, but he did, as his teammate is also going to grab one himself, but get chased down by Kimbo. Kimbo wants his kill. You've been in my base far too long, Sunshine. Get the hell out of here. 33-31 is the score. 6:38 on the clock. Going toe-to-toe with Cristola. Cristola sits it back, and all of a sudden we're into a one-kill game once again.
I mean, why is it that Dinosaurs are so often behind and have to make a comeback? They're definitely known as the comeback team in this squad, but I don't know if you can do it against U4X, because once U4X get into that commanding position, they're very hard to break down. But as I say that, the Dinosaurs are striking back. They are one ahead now on the scoreboard, and 57's got the sniper.
Yeah, this is a very important part of the game. Like you said, Sims, around the 35 kill mark, that's when you need to keep it close and edge into a lead if you want to win the game. Dinosaurs did very, very well in order to keep this close up until this point, and now when the sniper comes up, 57 can absolutely blame the player waiting for it. Can he hit the no scope? He actually tags Moz. That's another double double. That's a double-double now for 57, and he will drop the new sniper.
What's going to be interesting is he's going to reload that, get some extra bullets. But it's where he goes from here, grabs the no-scope onto Foxy. Nades go in. I really want to see him back off now and go towards his teammates. Because he has no shield, he needs to stay alive. But those rockets are super, super crucial. May change the way of the game, whoever's got them. I believe it's in the hands of a U4X player.
Yeah, Moses got the rockets, and he is waiting around the corner for 57. 57 is literally just running away from every single U4X moment. He has got an absolutely huge sniper in his hands, and he needs to stay alive with it. He knows if he gives this away, that could be the extinction of the dinosaurs. But they've got a 4-kill lead, and 57 is still just running away from everything, trying to get some control right now.
Yeah, they know where they need to go. And finally, they actually shut down Moses. He's not been allowed to get many kills with that. Scopes in, doesn't unfortunately land the second shot. Another grenade goes in just to try and lay down a bit of covering fire for anybody who wants to try and make their way towards him. We'll move back towards the bridge though, see if he can scope in and get any lines of sight on any players that want to be spawning in the back of red. But he needs to be careful of this left-hand side. We can see 1, 2, 3, 4 outlines of blue players advancing hard through the maze and through the pyramid area. He's going to move back towards this blue elbow at this moment in time. Just copped the edge of Respectful's head. Didn't fire the bullet, so there'll be no kill there. But you know what? Flames is going to clear up with the carbine. 4-kill lead now for the Dinosaurs. The pressure is well and truly on you, 4X.
I can't say enough about how much I love 57's rotations. He got the call that his team were at red, so he rotated from blue to red. He was still being pressured at red, so he rotated all the way back to blue, and now he's at top rockets with the sniper. This is such an advantageous position here, Sims.
And one thing that, you know, fair enough, there's only one more kill left to seal this deal, but look where he is. He's got the rockets. If they come up, it's game, set, and match. It doesn't matter whatsoever. Ladies and gentlemen, Cristola grabs the final kill, and there you have it. The Dinosaurs put 1 point on the board and give U4X their second loss of the European Pro League. Harry, run us through the kill feed.
57, the man I highlighted. I loved his rotations. 14 kills, joint most in the game, and the least deaths in the game as well. Great job from him. 20, not firing as much as we want him to, but he had 7 assists and his team did win the game, so we won't be too upset about that. I like how he kept it under 12 deaths as well. We talk about it constantly. 12 deaths, if you get more than that, it's way too many in a Slayer, because 12 times 4 is 48. There's some maths for you. And on the other side, Respectful, 10 assists, 11 kills, but again, U4X just not able to fire enough against the Dinosaurs. And Dinosaurs take the second map here off of U4X in the Pro League.
I said Dinosaurs were a comeback team, but at no point were they more than 2 kills behind in that game. They kept them within a distance, and then it just got to the last bit, and 57 staying alive with that sniper was just absolutely crucial. He was just literally running away from any noise. Even if it was a teammate, it was like, I want to go the other way. Just in case, I'm not losing this sniper. And then he positioned himself on the rocket side just in case he had to throw it off the map. That's what I like.
Quite a rarity that we see not only Moz going negative, but then Respectful going negative, and then Kimbo going negative as well. Not a really great game. I mean, is it fair to say that this is just simply one of the Dinosaur's stronger maps?
Well, we said we haven't seen U4X at all in the Pro League on this map, and I think we found their Achilles heel. So maybe this might be a veto in the future for the U4X squad in the future. We saw 57 here. I'm pretty sure he stayed alive until the end of the game here. He still has this sniper. He picked up the sniper, rotated from snipe to red. From red to blue, from blue to rockets, and ended the game. It was incredible. Great rotations out of 57. And how many times do we say it? When 57 plays well, yeah, Dinosaurs win games. They really is a key player for that team.
And you just kind of touched on briefly about the veto systems, and maybe you'll be able to see this going forward, Dan, as you do them. Now when people see the Dinosaurs, we're like, okay, we're getting Collie out of there, because this is clearly a game type that not only do they love, but they can win. On your screens right now, there's the score line to prove it. 50-44 is the final score of game number 2, which means ba 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 bam, we're getting a truth that captured the flag, which is exactly what I like to see, because, you know, I'm a big truth fan.
I mean, we spoke about vetoes. Snakey was actually the guy that was doing the vetoes for U4X, and now he's left.
Ooh.
And actually, U4X are playing Colosseum Slayer against Vibe tomorrow as well. So Vibe will be, they'll be rubbing their hands together saying, okay, so there is a chink in the armor. We might be able to take these guys down. And I mean, so Foxy has been on the team for, what, a couple of days? He's already dropped one map. Snakey was on it for 4 weeks and only dropped one map. That's all I'm saying.
Savage. Talk about throwing him at the boss.
The thing is, when you throw four really strong slayers, sometimes you kind of have that hierarchy of who's going to be doing what. And I think once they find that right mixture, they're going to be an absolute dominant force.
Just to note there as well, you can see on screen, guys, for everything HCS Pro League, proleague.com/Halo, all the fixtures, all the VODs, all the scores, everything is on demand. We updated the team photos for all the European profiles there. If you want to know all the profiles, you want to know the Twitters, YouTubes, Twitch, every single thing to do with Pro League, ba-bum-bum. This man is doing a fantastic job. So get yourselves over there, take a look. All the information for signing up for the open circuit is there. Also, seriously, in fact, there you go. It just popped up on screen. So if you want the portal for the open circuit, esl.gg/EU Open, $1,000 per week per region. I can't say this enough, guys. That's $750 to a European team who wins on a Sunday. And remember, this is your key route into the Pro League. The people who finish after the Open Circuit Finals, the top two teams after finals, get a shot and get a crack at the fall seasons. Truly, truly incredible stuff. And again, you can see on there, catch the VODs. If you want to watch them all live, proleague.com/Halo. But if you want to watch them on demand any single time of the day and you want to see them when they go up on the day, get yourself over to YouTube. We are on ESL Halo. Everything's in there. I spent hours organizing all those playlists, man. I've gone all the way back. We've got the community montage section on there as well, but you go back all the way to the Gamescom MCC release. Every single event from MCC onwards is on there, locked, loaded. Get subscribed.
That was the first ever Slayer U4X have lost in the Pro League.
Really?
Yeah. They lost the Capture the Flag last week to Pulse, and that was their only loss previously. I mean, I just wanted to be dramatic, okay, Dan. I wanted to make it sound more important than it was, but...
No, it's a big stat at the end of the day, because we've got a team change, and all of a sudden...
And they just made the team change to add more firepower.
Did work.
Didn't work.
Well, let's give him the benefit of the doubt for now. How it goes. And Strongholds, game number 3 on Eden is right up about now, guys. Of course, remember, tweet the stream. Use the hashtag HCS. This is game number 3. The Dinosaurs putting up one hell of a fight so far against this new U4X roster. Moe's caught off guard. Grenades going in thick and fast. Two foxes behind him. However, I don't think he caught for him back. There were too many grenades. So he may have just got away with the smoke with his life. For Buck 20, he's on a rampage right now. Kimbo's as well gets taken out by flames across the map. I think that's possibly all four dead.
I love this like opening start from Buck 20 as well, just grabbing that battle rifle, sitting bottom mid, putting shots across, and then flanking round behind up to that catwalk. Great use of map positioning and of course getting the battle rifle. I love to see the battle rifle being used more and more as we develop into this Pro League.
Unfortunately, Respectful doesn't manage to get that beat down off as he did just kind of get stuck in and give it a little bit of a go, but two plots are now on the board for the Dinosaurs and they are racking up the points. Two Foxy will challenge, they'll go one-on-one even though he's got no shields, will drop a pre-grenade as well just as he backs down to possibly see if he can get any hit markers off on that player. He does indeed and then beats him down. All of a sudden, the plots are transferring back into the hands of the Dinosaurs. You can see now Buck 20. He will get challenged, but he will sit him down. But he needs to be careful because if Respectful didn't kill him, certainly Moe's will have done. They really need to take Moe's down now. But you know, Kimbo being very, very sneaky, unfortunately misses that jump. Otherwise, that could have been quite dangerous because his camo's just run out.
Yeah, I couldn't decide if he had just intentionally dipped down because he saw a player up there, but I think he did just miss the clamber. But it actually paid out in his favor because he was able to take a different like vantage point and get the kill. A very important kill as well because they will keep control of that catwalk as Kimbo is going to wait and take on 57 and easily out battle rifle him there.
Two more players are collapsing in on the blue bend just to try and rekindle it and retake it. But honestly, at this moment, I mean, you always want to try and push for the three plots, but in theory, they kind of can just sit back and let the kills come to them and just keep slaying over and over again. Let's just jump on board with somebody else. We get a little bit of a different POV after this gunfight's over and done with to see where they're going. Because at the moment in time, Kimbo kind of were just looking a little bit on his own. 57's now here while his teammates just getting that nest. But we're going to see Respectful coming in. We've seen Respectful do this before. He crouches down. It takes three of them to actually finally end his life.
It was a really interesting position actually there from Kimbo. I mean, it's the first time I think we've seen on a broadcast, we've seen someone actually anchor that top nest stronghold. So, oh wow, 57 actually gets the backsmack there on the overshield player. 57 starting to heat up. He did get killed by Kimbo early on fairly easily. It's nice to see 57 back in this game and firing now.
And that's kind of, you know what I mean, fair enough. If you don't get the kill with Brute PI, you can at least just take his shields off and push him back, which is what he did. Unfortunately, didn't didn't quite land on the blue spawn. They came straight off and took him down. 20's going to grab a double kill as well, one with a perfect. Now we move on board with Flames, who's got himself a couple of little rockets in his back pocket to do some damage with. Just taking control of this blue bend. All they need to do is slay, 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 and make sure they don't get any more plots on the board. Going to look around this corner to see where they're at. Just checking. Respectful's chasing one. Ooh, I'm going to say almost grit triggered discipline, but a little bit too much.
I think I would have just risked it for a chocolate biscuit there and just fired it in and accepted that I was going to kill my teammate and guaranteed the kill. I mean, these rockets don't do as much damage as the original rockets that we saw in Halo 5, but they definitely do enough damage to take down two people.
This is a really strange game of Strongholds. It's starting to heat up a little bit now, but early on, we really didn't see much action from either team. You remember the old U4X team, who, by the way, have never lost a Strongholds game type? They used to fly every single Strongholds together. Whenever we were watching U4X in the past, they constantly used to fly at teams. We're not really seeing that in this game so far, but now they're starting to push the pace and push the Dinosaur Stronghold, which is Red Nest.
No hit markers from that grenade. He did just try and get some off and support his teammates over in the nest. Needs to be careful of the sneaky though. He sees him on the radar, but he's crouched down. Will come in, gives him the quite easy shoulder bash, takes him down. There's another player there. I think that's possibly 2-on-2 either side at the moment. As we look across, there's dead POVs across the board. Blue Ben's getting transferred. This could be the 3-cap and the 3-plus, what they need to really extend that lead. And you know what? They're going to get it. Nobody's challenging Respectful whatsoever. Rockets have just popped as well. Let's see who managed to bag them in the back, because that could be a game-changing set.
U4X just kind of have spread themselves across the whole map, and they are more than happy to take loads of individual fights. And they just kind of swarm around each other, and actually their teamwork seems to be getting better as this series progresses. I mean, Harry said that the old U4X, they would just swarm like straight away. Now it seems like they're a little bit more patient about their play. Despite the aggression, they decide when they want to push for that third plot. They were very happy just to control two. There seems to be a lot more kind of thought process behind their play right now.
The thing is though, Moz grabs the rockets, as we mentioned a second ago, gets a double kill instantly. There's one. Respectful grabs himself. Very, very sneaky, very sneaky. Just crouch down, let him come to him. SMG beats him down as well. But yeah, it's full power weapon control at the moment. Camo and rockets in the bag. Respectful's going to just try and hunt down Cristola now with the SMGG in his hand. Cristola somehow absolutely making it away with his life. Will challenge. It was a great challenge and a great effort. He had nowhere else to really go because he had another player up in the top middle section as well, waiting for him in the sight of Moz. And now it's just a matter of playing it out. Run 95 points. It's a 3-cap. I think that's going to be game, set, and match down.
Yeah, a really strong performance and a great response after losing game 2. U4X needed that. If they were to struggle in that game, I would probably have given the series to Dinosaurs, because I think Dinosaurs would have just carried the momentum through to the rest of the series.
That was kind of a crazy game. That was actually really close for the early part. And then we just saw U4X turn on the Jets. They just absolutely dominated the Dinosaurs in the second half of the game. 4 caps, 16 kills, and 3 secures out of Respectful. Great job out of him. And all round, really, it was a great slaying performance here out of U4X. And the other side, Dinosaurs, single-digit kills across the board. They just couldn't seem to keep up with the firepower, which came as a result of the map control from U4X.
Yeah, not the best of game when it comes to slaying when we look at Cristola. However, he still had 2 plots, you know, 2 captures, 3 captures coming out of 57. You mentioned earlier on how important it is for the captain to kind of do as well as he is. Sometimes we see a bad game, 57, and the team kind of staggers and follows him. But overall, that's the U4X that we know and love, and has the capabilities to keep going kind of and been on this undefeated run that they've been on so far.
I mean, interestingly, Eden Strongholds is one of U4X's most vetoed maps. So the fact that they can win a map that they maybe aren't that confident with really speaks volumes.
Neither team had played that game type in the Pro League before. That was both the team's first outing on Eden Strongholds. So it's interesting that you say U4X vetoed that map the most, considering they've never played it before in the Pro League. So they clearly must know it's one of their maps they need to work on, and they still dispatched the Dinosaurs pretty handedly. They did really well, actually. They surrendered the first 2 strongholds to the Dinosaurs and then got control. Dinosaurs here were able to come back. This backsmack out of 57, that's a really big play on Kimbo. But again, you've got to look at the score. I believe it got up to around 25-25, and then from there on, U4X got a hold on the map and they just never let it go.
I think, how long was the 3-cap? The 3-cap was certainly, did it get broken at the end, or just a full-on?
I think it got broken
maybe once or twice, but it was majority of 3-cap once that one. And that's what happened. That's what U4X are more than capable. That's what we know they're capable. And that's the kind of scoreline that we've been seeing. And what I kind of expect to see now, especially if that's them just really heating up and finding a foothold as a team. As you can see on screen now, we're moving back into another capture the flag. It's going to be on the one, the only. It is Truth this will be game, set and match if they claim this. And I did say we might see a game four. We, of course, asked, definitely seen a game four. Is everything possible to see a game five, or is this U4X now steam ahead?
I mean, I don't want to speak too much on vetoes, but this is Dinosaur's least vetoed map for True CTF, so clearly they want to be playing this map.
Which is interesting because they've never won it in the Pro League. They're 0-3 on this game type, and U4X are 2-0. So U4X undefeated, Dinosaurs haven't had a win, and the last time these two met, U4X took it 3-2. So if you're a betting man, no, Dinosaurs probably not going to take this game.
That was the game where it was 2-1, and then Dinosaurs got overly aggressive, and then it went to overtime, if I'm correct.
I think this was the one.
It was where we were questioning, should they have just sat back? And I touched on it earlier during the Fathom game, that sometimes when Dinosaurs do have that lead, they're not sure whether to be pushing or sitting back.
I always feel sorry for Dinosaurs on the Truth CTF after the Infused game that we saw up earlier on in the Pro League, where they got the initial, it went too high with the ground pound and he stalled it, and then Warlord just pulled that wild, wild flag run. It was truly, truly incredible. Just shortly, guys, we want to give you a quick shout out to some of the people of the community out there. You can see on the bottom, stats, 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 Halo5Arena.com. I hear you're a bit of a fan of these, Harry. Do you use this website quite?
I'm right now.
It's open. It's open on your screen. This site is truly, truly incredible. If you guys want to know about players, map wins, deaths, kills, ratios, assists, don't matter what it is, this website has it all. It's what Harry uses for a lot of the statistics. So big shout out and big up to all the guys over at Halo5Arena.com. It truly is an incredible, incredible website. It just gives so much more in-depth and so much more knowledge to what's going on and really what we don't see. Because the figures, as you've said plenty of times and what you've said plenty of times, the stats do tell a story.
Yeah, they really give a great indication in terms of what's going on in the game. One thing I love the most is the head-to-head duels. I mean, we can see right now that 57 didn't win a single head-to-head duel against any of the U4X members that game. So, Truth capture the flag coming up next, Sims. Dinosaurs need the next two games to win this series.
Who you want to kick things off with, Dan? Who's your player to keep an eye on?
I've got to be looking at 2Foxy. I mean, I've been questioning him, but he has actually been playing really well. I mean, the team's, I don't think it's quite as strong as what U4X were, but there is definitely a lot of potential shining through.
All right, then, let's kick things off. As he grabs the sword, we'll run straight and just go steamboating into the enemy's base. He's got one player behind him. He's not actually noticed. He was more concentrating on the guy in the radar dropping down from above him. So the sword's going to transfer back into the hands of Buck 20. I just want to have a look at how this one is kind of going to play out, how we feel as casters this one's going to play out. Obviously, U4X know that this is the seal or deal, but Dinosaurs also know if they want to see Game 5, they have to win it. The pressure is most definitely on. Do you think we're going to see a much more passive game?
No, I don't think you could ever describe any U4X game as passive. They've just got so many aggressive players. I mean, we saw it a lot during the EMEA regional finals. 2Foxy, if he sees that sword, he will grab it. He will go under the base. He will just flank around. He will be an absolute nuisance.
This man right here who just got a double and has just cleaned up 20. In fact, that's two doubles in a row now for Respectful. Went off in the last game. He actually went 16-6 with the most captures. He actually had a 2.67 kill-death ratio. He does go down in the end. So let's swap over to the Dinosaur side. Don't forget, they need to win this game and the next in order to win this series.
Harry's always trying to get digs in about his fantasy league every single time, at every single moment. We're looking across the board then. 57's going to see 2Foxy coming up on the right-hand side. He's used the jump lift. Kimbo will be on the opposing side, and here comes the flag run. But there's going to be really no one kind of there to support on the higher end. Saying that, I've just caught for a player top mid. So we got 57 here who's stopping the advancement from the P side, and we've got his teammate who's top mid. That would have been quite a big kill for him if he got that, but he's not. He's ignoring it. He's just being this nuisance. He's going to stick on the radar. We've got Kimbo top mid. He's going to go one-to-one to him. If he could get that kill, wow, doesn't matter. Cristola's going to grab it. That's going to be a flag cap. Truly incredible stuff. Cristola just puts himself in a place just to stop any advancement.
That was classic, kind of just Halo 2 flag run. They got 3-4 down. They were just like, there's 3 dead. Let's just pull the flag. We know where they're going to spawn. They blocked the spawns correctly. They spawned under the base. and 57 was just there just to be a nuisance, just to kind of get in the way, and then you had Cristola just cleaning everything up they had put shots on.
I mean, I can only imagine that he came off the spawn and run straight from his base and just dive bombed to top mid, because I did not see him on that map when they were making that pull whatsoever. Mose is going to get a clean run, probably going to be a stealth capture. Yes, it is indeed. There's the medal. U4X will answer back in a very, very quick and fast way. Two players on either side going down on the kill feed. Mose going toe-to-toe with Buck 20. Buck 20 will sit him down.
It was exactly the same as well for U4X. They kind of just, they slayed them. They knew they were spawning under the base. I think under the base is the hardest place to break out from. If you do spawn there, you're really going to struggle to get back that flag.
And of course, they didn't manage to. Both teams have just pretty much run it neck and neck. Will two go play? Two players will go down. 9 minutes remaining on the clock. One flag capture each. No flag is pulled at this moment in time. We see Moe's going more passive. Flames will run up with the sword, but unfortunately eat a face full of lead from the AR.
I believe the camouflage is coming up fairly soon. It might have been last minute, actually, so we could have another minute. I was wondering why 57 was down at pink one. It was a very strange position to be. I wonder whether or not he was actually just challenging the camouflage. I'll keep an eye on that for you guys. But at the moment, Kimbo here, great top middle control. He just seems to be bossing it a lot. I mean, we saw throughout the flag cap, while 57 was doing that great job at the front of the U4X base, Kimbo actually took down, I think it was Buck 20 who was top middle. He decided to, hey, you know what? We're not going to stop this flag. Let me just get that top middle control back for my team. That's what he did during the flag run for the Dinosaurs, and that's what he's doing right now.
And obviously a big thing, if U4X win this map and win the series, they are guaranteed a place at the finals of the HGS EU Pro League. So it's a big moment for them. It's a big moment for Foxy as the new member. So they are going to want to finish this one up nice and quickly. They're not going to want it let go to overtime.
I think, Dan, we just have to make a quick note. I mean, I'm going to be cursed to the caster here. How, oh my days, how long has Kimbo been alive? We've been on this POV now for maybe 2-3 minutes, and he's just not died, and he just keeps moving back and forth. He's been from top mid, he's been to pink 3, he's been to pink 1. Now he's making an advancement down the pink ramp and into the red base to try and put a little bit more pressure on this guy that he absolutely knows, definitely knows he's hiding inside that window. Now we'll move back up because 20's going to get called out of the top mid. Unfortunately, he does not get the kill. Finally, Kimbo will get shut down.
Extremely important kill to shut down Kimbo there. That's the thing with Truth now. Because of that carbine in that BR placement, you really can control those towers with those rifles. And especially on Slayer, it can really snowball out of control. On flag, yes, okay, you're going to have the control of the map, but you still need to push in for that flag, so it allows the other team to kind of break that setup. But the fact that Kimbo was taken down and he wasn't able to control that tower is very important for the Dinosaurs.
I'd like to possibly say Respectful may have not meant to hit that lift. I think he was trying to thrust across it and just run down the bottom section to his teammate who was waiting there. But you know what? It doesn't matter. Moe's got his favourite weapon. He's got a storm rifle in the back pocket, and he has camo to boot as well. Cristola comes straight down. Face and face full of lead. Flag's there. Flag is capped. They're going for another one as well, as Moe's will just try and stay alive. No shield whatsoever, but this camo is super, super important because he can just be a royal pain in the backside. Flames will challenge. You know what? Moe says, challenge accepted, Sunshine. I've got a storm rifle, and I'm going to rip you apart. 57 comes down on the flag. They're trying to get the return and really desperate this. Buck 20's putting some great shots on Moe, though, to just kind of keep him off that flag, because if they would have got a touch that would have been another pull and probably another flag cap.
Yeah, at the moment, U4X, they've just got so much map control, and they've got so much desire and so much passion that they're just pushing into this flag and pulling these flags. And Moe, I said earlier, you've got to have that guy who is happy to be in the back line, happy to be a nuisance. The fact he got the flag straight away and then just dropped back with that camo, it just means that these Dinosaurs have to constantly be looking behind their backs. They don't have a chance to think, don't have a chance to breathe.
That kind of mini 30-second spell of pressure there on the Dinosaur base was all off Moe's, just timing the camouflage and grabbing it. He got the kill bottom middle, then he was straight in the Dinosaur's base. Even though his team were running a flag, he was being a royal pain in the backside, as you said, Sims. And it was just a great job. He was constantly behind the Dinosaur squad. They had to come back. They had to worry about him. He pretty much held up the entire team whilst his team captured the flag and then were able to run back straight over to the Dinosaur's base. I love the play out of Moe's.
I know we give Kimbo a lot of credit for his ability to stay alive, but I have to give credit to his team for helping him, giving that ability to stay alive, because several times we see him going toe-to-toe with a player and all of a sudden a bullet will just come flying out of nowhere. He'll get the call, a teammate will answer, a carbine or a magnum just comes flying through the air, and all of a sudden the guy is going 1-to-1 that's about to kill him. He's pinged out of nowhere. We now see Kimbo with the fresh camo. That's why he was constantly controlling that, you know, just around that P section, because he knew it was coming up. This is now a bit of a deadly combination. He's got the camo, he's got the fuel rod, and he's going to find a couple of dinosaurs who want to get a bit of a green screen for the win.
Yeah, U4X is just really timing these weapons and timing the power-ups really effectively, and dinosaurs are going to struggle to respond to that because camo is so detrimental when it is in the hands of the opposition team, and U4X at the moment looking really strong. They just really need to control this map. They don't need to overextend. They don't need to necessarily pull the flag. At this moment in time, they probably could just continue to slay for 4.5 minutes.
I think it will be really hard, actually, for dinosaurs to come back in this game unless they can break the spell of possession that U4X have. They've had two back-to-back, and they've been able to do a lot of damage and hold up the Dinosaurs team. So basically, Dinosaurs need to get two flag caps without any camouflage control, unless they can somehow snatch a camouflage off of U4X.
One thing I have to say about these players that I have noticed, not a lot of them are using the ground pound, not a lot of them are using, you know, the Spartan charge. They're just kind of relying on their map movement with the thrust and the stabilizers. One thing that is so important that I always see about U4X, we don't see a massive usage on the Spartan abilities. It's all about the map movement and all about their thrusters every single time. We'll just run straight to the left again from 57 there. And this is kind of what we're seeing ongoing with these Europeans, like in the American Pro Leagues quite a few times. I see a lot more players using and utilizing those Spartan abilities. Dan, just as I'm saying this, I think we've got a Dinosaurs advancement.
Well, Dinosaurs were able to get four down for U4X. Kimbo was trying to flank around, but I don't think anyone is going to be able to stop this one as Flames is going to use the ground pound. There is a teammate. Thankfully, 57 was there. That was flashbacks there. I was a bit concerned, but now the Dinosaurs need to be careful of this counter cap. This could be what U4X were just more than happy to wait for. But Flames spawns, and he's able to get the kill. Really important that Respectful was taken down. He can get the double as well. Fantastic from Flames here.
If you're all kind of wondering what we're talking about there, that has happened before to the Dinosaurs. They were literally on the edge of grabbing a flag, but unfortunately, Infuse stopped them right on the edge and managed to get a counter cap. Kind of almost the same scenario coming off the back of the ground pound. In come Cristola now. He's got the noob combo in hand. This weapon is as dirty as it was back in Halo 2. Will land it off on 2 Foxy. Gets the assist medal as well. His teammates behind him to help him out. We're going to see Kimbo drop downstairs. They're going to grab this flag now and move it because he's got support from the left-hand side. Third-person mode in effect. But they need to be careful of that top middle section. If anybody just comes steamboating across with grenades, with bullets, they're going to take down this flag run. But a beautiful play from Cristola. Please don't challenge. He did so well to stay out. But I think that's going to be game, set, and match. They need to get this kill and stop that pull. They've managed to do it indeed, but they're coming in on the left-hand side. Please get the return. Oh, no, it's getting a little bit messy. There's several players there. One of them sitting down. Two more are running in. They're kind of just desperate, and this is all a bit messy. Cristola's there as well. But Kimbo is running away with it down the bottom middle section. Buck 57's also caught off guard. It's a bit of a mess down the bottom mid. Everything's going wrong.
Heating up at the moment. Kimbo did fantastically to kind of jump into that base. Flames is going to get the return. They are going to put this flag cap in. They're going to tie this series 2-2. The Dinosaurs are taking it to U4X right now.
Oh my holy mess up bottom mid. I think we both kind of lost for words, and I kind of lost track of what was going on. There were several players. Hopefully we can get something on the replay there to really see what happened at the end, because it just spiraled. In the words of Anchorman, that escalated quickly.
What a ridiculous series of play there out of Dinosaurs. We saw Flames on our screens wildly spraying P1 purely because they didn't know when the camouflage was coming up. They assumed, hey, you know what? U4X have had the last two camouflage. I'm pretty sure we're just going to have to guess when it comes up. And I said, Sims, in the commentary, they need to get two flag caps without the camouflage. That's exactly what they did. Moe's with 24 kills, Kimbo with 23, Respectful with 22, but it doesn't matter. Dinosaurs get the flag caps. They win the game.
Tweet the stream, use the hashtag HCS in capital letters. Game 5 alert. We finally, could this be the fall of U4X? Could they lose their first series in the European Pro League? This is insane. We've never seen this amount of pressure from any team, and I can only imagine Snakey's at home right now, ready for his Pro League match, kind of kicking back, just going, well, I certainly wasn't the problem. But we're still only in the early stage. I have to give credit to these guys and how good they are and how talented they are. And I don't want to be disrespectful in any way to the Dinosaurs, because right now those guys are absolutely playing fantastic, fantastic Halo.
I mean, U4X made a change for the long run, right? They knew they were performing well, but they're probably looking at the Americans saying, how can we beat these Americans? They've said, 2 Foxy, one of the best players, let's bring him in as well. This is where we saw Flames just kind of try and ground pound. We got a little bit worried about that. But just a great response from the Dinosaurs. We say they are the comeback kings, and this was when things started to get a little bit hectic.
That's one flag, two flag, three flag. So three people have died now. That's a fourth pull. Down he goes.
This right here.
Yeah, that was the change. So that's the fifth pull there. So that's five Dinosaur players. That one finally gets returned, I believe, at the bottom. Yep. Another player died in the base, so that was six times. So the Dinosaurs were actually slayed, team-wise, 1.5 times, but they desperated that flag so much, they still got the cap and the win at the end.
But I don't know if you saw on that death cam, it's kind of like a surveillance cam, we saw, was it Cristola, his teammate touched the flag, but Mose was flying in, and you saw Cristola, he saw Mose with no shields, he got the beatdown on him, and then he was just windmilling everywhere. I was like, oh god, this is such an important kill. He took his time, he got it in the end, and they get the return, and force a game five.
Truly incredible stuff. On your screen right now, how this one has played out, folks. If you are just joining us, welcome along. U4X took the initial game 2-3. That was a very, very close out series. Dinosaurs managed to pretty much at the end really extend a win on game number two, Colosseum Slayer, to win the game 50-44. U4X with a very commanding victory in game number three. That was Eden Stronghold's 125. And then what we have just seen was, it was wild. I think we both kind of lost us footing at the end there, so I do apologize for that. But truly incredible stuff. I want to say, and I want to put this to both of you here, do you think the last cap was a bit of a luck pull, or do you think one team really kind of messed up and should have been on top of that one?
I think Dinosaurs know when they want to pull a flag. Yep. They're just like, look, we're going to run them, we're going to pull this flag, and we are going to work. They just work as a unit to pull that flag back. They make sure they've got players top mid, they make sure they've got a guy blocking the spawn. I just think they are the comeback kings. They're just more than happy to be behind and then try and just ruffle stomp the other team.
If you want to talk about YOLO pulls, 57 had 6 returns. Whether he's stopping actual flag runs, I highly doubt it. I'm pretty sure U4X were the team trying to pull that flag early. And we saw that in the Fathom Catch the Flag game that Dinosaurs lost. They were the ones trying to pull that flag early. They were the ones trying to spring the attack as fast as possible. And it came back to bite them in the backside in that game. And the exact same things happened to U4X in that last game that we just saw.
I mean, U4X just had so much map control, and I said they probably didn't need to pull a flag and they could just continue slaying. When they did push in and try and pull a flag, that was then when the Dinosaurs kind of regained a little bit of map control, and that's when they started to get those map pulls. I mean, slaying for 4.5 minutes is probably never a good idea, but they did give up map control when they pushed into the flag.
Question then. Okay. I'll start off with Harry first, and I'll move on to yourself.
Oh, good.
Just really quickly, before we do some more community shout-outs, moving into a Slayer for game number 5, Harry.
Yep.
It's truth. Any statistics about these two teams?
None really that stand out. I mean, I would have said that on this game type, U4X are undefeated, but they've only played it once. Dinos are 1-1. This game type is very, very snowbally because there are only 2 rifles on the map. And if you can grab the rifle in the VR tower, and if you can grab the carbine and stay up high and pin them in a base, it's really, really hard to break out of that kind of setup. So it's pretty hit and miss for me.
I mean, basically, if U4X do what they did in that flag game, they will win this Slayer game.
And because we're kind of going to be my next question then. If you're betting, guys, Dan, start for you. Who's going to take game 5?
I think U4X will still take this, even though I want the Dinosaurs to win. I'm not going to lie. I just think that they deserve it after that performance.
I think he's going to say different.
Well, he would probably just disagree with me for the hell of it.
I'm saying Dinos.
I'm saying Dinos, baby.
I believe.
Can it be done? Believe. The dream is alive. Game 5 is about to kick up underway, guys. couple of shout-outs again. We want to shout out our guys over at the Halo Wiki. This used to be Halo Esports Pedia. We're now the Esports Wiki. It says on there, know more than your friends about the HCS. You know what? This isn't knowing more about your friends about the HCS. This is knowing more about your friends about any kind of competitive Halo player. We looked on there earlier on. You've got players, teams, who they've represented in the past, their wins, their achievements, every single event, archive, competition that Halo has had, the standings, the rosters, the players that were on those rosters, the casters, the events, the companies, the sponsors, you name it, these guys have archived it. That is, if I want to know anything about players, that's where I go.
I wish they'd go a little bit further back to the tournaments when I was placing top 3 and stuff.
No one cares about them.
Have you ever been on the Wonderboy page on there? It says best dressed Halo caster alive, best looking Halo. Hey, no, you don't know that.
Although that is a very... G-Man, would be...
G-Man would love that.
He would
that
love
jacket.
That. That is a G-Man jacket.
Please, Golden Boy could,
speaking of
could
jackets.
Not pull off this suit, I can tell you that much.
It's not very nice, is it?
Well, I'm not a very nice person, so I suppose it works out.
So, speaking of jackets, hey! Well, guys, we've got a giveaway. You can, of course, now jump on over to ESL.gg. Go there now, HCSEU4. You get a chance to get geared up for the HCS Pro League with Jinx. We have one Halo hoodie, two Halo t-shirts, and five Halo lanyards. These are codes. You enter them, you get your prizes sent to your house direct. Truly, truly awesome. I've got one of the Halo hoodies, and honestly, doesn't fit me anymore because of the weight loss, which is extremely disappointing because it's a cracking, cracking hoodie. Go there now. You saw it on screen. Join in the competition, jump in, and win yourself some incredible prizes from Jinx. Game 5, gents. We're about to rock and roll and get this one underway. It's going to be a hyped-up game. Looking forward to see what happens. Could this be the revival of the dinosaurs? Could we see they've taken down a giant before in the form of X-Men? Could we see U4X's first loss of the European Pro League?
I don't think this will be a close game. I said it before, this is a very, very snowbally game type now with the rifle control of either team. I'm pretty sure whoever can control these rifles will come out as the victor in this game and in this series.
And we saw how well U4X did it last game. These dinosaurs just need to quickly get to those towers. They need to assert their dominance from the off, because if they allow U4X to set up like they did, they're going to be in for a horrible game five.
Buck 20 will drop down to the middle section. Bottom mid. He didn't mean to use the ground pound for just as long. He was trying to get onto that ledge to clamber up. Didn't quite land it. Found himself in the death zone and give away an easy death. Respectful will scope in. Take on one brother. There comes the other one in the form of 57. Takes down his teammate to his left. And now he's forced to back off with no shield. However, I'm hearing the fuel rod is in full effect. Kimbo comes screaming through with no shield. I'm assuming they were being directly aimed his way.
It does look like dinosaurs have got early map control as well. U4X are kind of stuck in this base, and it's going to be a case of how well are they going to push out. 57 does perhaps overextend and push in too early. A couple of the dinosaurs are taken down, and perhaps they're going to give away this map control, as now Kimbo is in that place once again with that carbine. If he does what he did last game, then dinosaurs are going to be looking up and trying to find out how they're going to take him down.
So this is the danger zone, as Harry mentioned earlier on, for dinosaurs, because when you get control of the rifles, this is where Truth Slayer really, really starts to escalate. You really want to get Kimbo out of this area now. He's just going to lock down carbine so nobody can advance. He's just going to ping players and get them weak. You can see there the golden arrows are racking up on the left-hand side as the kill feed. We're going to see Respectful taking one. Cristola shuts him down, although that's good because they can dive in, claim his weapons, set to make a bit of an advancement on that carbine side. They're going to stop the advancement again. That's Cristola for the second time shutting down a player, trying to lock down carbine. And this is something we've seen for quite some time now. U4X really love to lock down that entire 50% line.
This camouflage is coming up very, very soon in the next 20 or so seconds. In the last game, we saw U4X get two back-to-back, so their camouflage control in the last game really spelled danger for dinosaurs. They can't afford to let U4X get camo for the rest of the game, otherwise it will be curtains for them.
Cristola is doing so much work right now. We saw a perfect onto Moe's. He was the one that took down Kimbo as well, kind of broke that map control that U4X had. It was extremely important because it allowed those dinosaurs to push out. Camo is up, but Cristola is going to get taken down by Kimbo, and that might mean a free camouflage for this U4X side.
I wanted to say, look at that, double perfects on the kill feed now for Kimbo. That entire time he sat in the corner on that ramp, nobody saw him. He waited until his first mate moved into P2, then he came in with a back whack on the sword guy, then got the double kill on the guy that came out of P2 to come back and help him. Then he picked up a third kill, a back-to-back perfect. This scoreline is now just extended by 5 kills, all down to that single play from Kimbo hiding and being super, super patient in the corner.
And what we see from 57 and 20 now, and these guys are just running around in twos, and it's what they need to do if they want to take down this U4X side. U4X are more than happy to take individual battles, but the dinosaurs need to say, no, we're not playing your game, we're going to take team fights instead.
Yeah, that's absolutely huge, and that's how you take down the riflers. Dinosaurs very well practiced on this game type. You can see why they wanted to play this in game number 5. They are 3 kills down at the moment, though. Moe's does have this, fuel rod. 57's taken down, but you got to say again, U4X were able to get that camouflage off a great play by, was it Kimbo, who was just crouched in that bubble? Just a great play out of him, and it pretty much allowed them that free camouflage, and now they're going to know the time for the rest of the game, and this really isn't spelling very good here for the Dinosaurs.
No, especially when we're seeing yet another double kill coming out of Foxy on the kill feed with the sword. You can just hear it being pulled out, ready to slice someone's face off. Another assist medal coming in from Respect, but something we see with this roster, assists are rife. But you know what? Moz gets perfect. Buck 20 will take him down. So finally, the fuel rod will transfer over to the hands of the Dinosaur. Let's see what kind of work they can do. Flame is going to come out of here. He's got a teammate. It's not actually a teammate. I do apologize. I thought it was. It's an enemy hiding in that corner. He's getting nowhere. That's twice now. If that's Kimbo, that's the second time he's just waited for someone to come to him, walk past, and then go for a kill.
Yeah, camouflage coming up this minute as well. You see in the kill feed, U4X across the board. It's Kimbo, Respectful, just pretty much working together. And I wouldn't be surprised to see 2Foxy here just dip down a P1, maybe pick up that camouflage, but instead he's going to help his team out top middle. And this is what I was talking about. As soon as you get the rifle, as soon as you get the power-ups, the power weapons, this game type, this map and game type combo just seems to snowball very, very quickly. And there you go, U4X up by around, what is it, like 13 kills right now. A pretty tough showing here for the Dinosaurs. Let's see if they can come back.
Yeah, as soon as you're like 6, maybe 5 kills down on this map, it's just a constant uphill struggle. You don't have map control. You've got to find a way to get map control. To be fair to the Dinosaurs, they were trying their best. They were running around in pairs. They were doing the right thing. But there's just too much slaying power from this U4X side. And actually, the addition of Foxy and his just amazing sword movement, I must say, is really adding something to this lineup.
But you know what? They're starting to claw things back a little bit. They're going to go down. Oh, you mentioned it. It's quite a detrimental amount, but the point kill's still on the board. They're not staked. They're now out of the stake territory and out of the zone. Foxy, though, just crouching around, waiting for someone just to find. And this is three times now we've seen this play from U4X. Ooh, Respectful comes in with a carbine, though. Absolutely lights him up from across the map. Takes him down. Foxy comes in with the hottest of perfects to shut down 57 inside his own base. And now Respectful with this carbine once again, just prowling around, waiting for anyone who wants to line up inside his reticle.
And the Dinosaurs are just taking individual battles from within their base. They're taking on carbines with pistols. They're taking on battle rifles with just a storm rifle, and they need to just choose one area of the map, either P or carbine, and push as an absolute unit. Their only hope now is to regain these towers together and then just play flawlessly. But U4X just have far too much control right now.
You absolutely called it, Harry. We're at the 6 minute mark. It's 44 to 26. They only need 6-5 more kills to seal the deal in game number 5. But what a performance so far from the Dinosaurs. They're really struggling in this game, I've got to say. But to get this far, it's still not over. Anything can happen. Miracles have happened before. But my God, if they want to climb this mountain, it's Mount Everest, if I've ever did see one. 46 to 29 is the current scoreline. 557. Anything still possible. Fresh camos up. Kimbo's going to grab that one to boot. A grenade comes in from across the map from Respectful. Another great assist and show of teamwork.
I mean, even with a 16-kill lead, they're still going to be grabbing the camo. Kimbo is still on top of that timing, which is going to be absolutely crucial. They only need 2 more kills, and 2 more kills does mean that they will be heading to the Pro League Finals.
And you called it perfect. It took the words right out of my mouth. If they get these 2 more kills, they solidify themselves at the Grand Finals. There you have it, guys. U4X. Week number 4, day number 1, still undefeated, but the pressure is well and truly on. Dinosaurs put up an incredible, incredible show of force. Commiseration to them. Would definitely not be disappointed by that performance in any way, shape or form.
No, definitely not. But how many times have we seen it on our stream, on our official broadcast? Respectful just going off. 15-5 in a Slayer. Great plays out of him and just a great result out of U4X. They knew what they needed to do on Truth Slayer. Only 7 deaths again out of Kimbo. It was just fantastic. 10 assists as well. It's hard to argue against the play of U4X. They know exactly what they needed to do. They said, hey, we need to keep these rifles. We need to keep the map control up on our side. That's exactly what they did. They grabbed the sword. They allowed their players to be sneaky throughout the bases. And it was pretty simple from there on.
Cristola doing Cristola things. Bit of a 4-15 down at the bottom for Flames. Someone definitely chucked a ton of water over him and died out his fire, unfortunately. Sorry,
wow.
I had to just put that really.
So savage.
The thing is,
the man's just lost in the Pro League Sims. Can you not?
Well, he got to game 5, though.
He got to game 5, which is something that no team has done against U4X.
Yeah.
And to be honest, it can happen on Truth when you're that far behind and you're just trying to do too much. Yes, okay, you had 4 kills, but those deaths are always going to come out at the end of the game just because you're constantly trying to regain map control.
Yeah, look at this right here, though. It's pretty simple. Excuse me. Pretty close, even here. 20-16. That's not an unsurmountable lead. But it seems like from here on, dinosaurs just seem to collapse. We see it here. The next replay, 37-25 is the score. And we see Respectful here. Check out these shots. Absolutely drilling the dinosaurs player. I believe that was 57. And again, Kimbo controlling the camouflage. That was the end of the game. And U4X, they win the series.
So, gents, the question I have to ask them, we've now... Definitely, we have to kind of cement U4X still at the top of the hierarchy, top of the food chain.
Just about.
Anything can happen, especially when we get into the arena downstairs for LAN finals. Anything can happen. It's a totally different ball game. As you can see on screen there, pretty much neck and neck all the way across. Interesting stuff from both sides, and just generally a fantastic, fantastic game. Number five. I've got to ask though, gents. Now we've seen the dinosaurs. They have reverse swept the X-Men. We've seen them push U4X to a game number five. Is this kind of, for you guys, the second best team in Europe right now?
Yes, I think so. I certainly think so. I mean, they went 0-2 last year. Last week. Excuse me, it's not been that long we've been playing Halo 5, guys. Come on. Last week they went 0-2. Cristola said, hey, it's pretty much because we didn't practice throughout the whole week. I said it this week, they're going to be more prepared. And I said that they would be the team to maybe take down U4X. They took them to a game five. That's pretty much unheard of in the Pro League. They had only dropped one map before this series. Dinosaurs took two. So I certainly think, so far, Dinosaurs probably the second best team in the league right now.
I think X-Men might have something to say about that, but Dinosaurs did beat X-Men. X-Men obviously have now made a change, so maybe we will be seeing the revival of the X-Men. But we said we're betting, and I won the bet. What do I get? Do I get breakfast tomorrow? Or
betting?
Well, yeah, you said you're a betting man, and you
I didn't say you're betting.
You're betting the dinosaurs.
Is breakfast paid for?
Yeah.
But then you get breakfast.
Yeah, you can get breakfast.
Cheers, mate. Thanks to yourself for my free breakfast.
See, I got you, fam. I'm helping you out.
Man.
And there you have it, guys. Game five, game set, match. U4X remain undefeated in the European Pro League. Truly, truly incredible stuff. But the dinosaurs proving that they are by no means defeated and no means extinct.
Don't say it. Extinct.
No, you've got to do it because they're just... It's so impressive. I mean, it's... Very, very disappointing game five. You know, that was really U4X at its finest and not the best of players from certain individuals on dinosaurs. But across the board, coming from what they're doing so far, I want to say that I, and probably many others, and it's fair to say, counted them out just a little bit at the initial start. We saw all the team changes. We saw all the stories unfolding. They had quite to get here from being invited into the Pro League, a direct invite, to getting bumped out of it again. Then going into another invited one, to getting bumped out of that, to Hafting. They've made their way all the way into this Pro League through open qualification. Personally, I question that roster a little bit, but right now, it's just, they're incredible. They're playing so, so well. I mean, did you expect this out of the books, so to speak, after the Epsilon split? Because... Kind of, I don't want to say they were in no way were they carried by Jim and Mike. I don't want to say that at all.
No.
But certainly, it was a good duo system. It was a damn good buddy system.
Definitely was, but I would never count out the Bucks. I think they're two fantastic players. I was questioning Cristola at first because I didn't really know how he was going to fit in. I didn't know how Flames was going to return after being a coach. But actually, Flames and Cristola have kind of become this duo as well. So then you've got that duo system. Okay, Jimbo and Snipe Drone is a little bit different, that you've got that sniper power and stuff, but Cristola is definitely really showing up right now, and he's probably my favorite player in the Pro League right now.
Yeah, to answer your question, I think they certainly were a dark horse coming into the league, and I don't think anyone would have expected them to be the team to push U4X to game five, apart from this guy right here, by the way. But I got to pick myself up somehow, okay? Why are you talking to me like that? Come on, man.
Don't pull that face. Credit where credit's due. I've seen you post on Beyond, and yeah, you're quite good at this.
I believe in the dinos.
It's a pity you're not very good at the little online fantasy thing, but we won't talk about that one anyway. Quick shout out to Tashi over at 343 the HCS Listen. If you want to be, get your questions out there, use hashtag HCS Listen in episode 3, ESL.gg/HCS Listen in number 3. This one features the man, the myth, the legend, Eric Rohner, Mr. Snipe Down. You were speaking about this one earlier on. It's a good episode this week, isn't it?
It is a good episode, mainly because they spoke for more than a couple minutes on Europe, so that was fun. But yeah, Snipedown, is always a really informative guest. He gives really long-winded answers, which is what you want out of a podcast. You want to hear the insights of players. You want to hear the insights of what's going on in a team's mentality. And that's exactly what Snipedown gives in this podcast, so I'd certainly give it a listen. And how can you not like Strongside's voice? I mean, it's just, it's silky. It
Mike's
really
voice
is
just... I always remember when we were at Halo Worlds and that one line of the most pivotal point in Halo history. And it'll just always... Don't tap him on the shoulder. Yeah, it wasn't I saw that.
I remember, I was at EMEA, so he said that.
It was. Yeah. Yes, it was.
I wasn't there either, so...
Yeah, I knew there was another dig coming out somewhere, to be honest with you. But so I've got to ask you then. Obviously, you've been to America yourself, Dan. You've seen how some of these players play out and stuff like that. We were speaking about a player like Snipedown. Mm-hmm. Currently, when you look at that U4X roster and how we have to imagine in our minds, and I know the mind of Respectful, his eyes on the prize, his eyes on America. We've seen him just unfortunately not make it there time and time again. In fact, we can actually ask him ourselves because the interview is now live. Mr. Brandon Rock and Roll Stones, can you hear us?
Hello, you boys.
What's going on, mate? You all right?
Yeah, not bad, man, not bad.
I can see you've been and done your hair just for this interview and put your fresh earrings in. So, once again, another win in the books, currently undefeated in the league. You've got your new member of 2Foxy on there. How's things going? How are you feeling about the roster?
I'm really confident about the roster. Despite the, well, obviously winning by one game today, like, we was going in thinking we was going to go over, like, kind of a 3-0 sort of thing. But nevertheless, like, we took the win. But definitely, I can already feel that we're a stronger team. And I mean, it's been like, what, a couple of days since the roster changes? We go over a lot more stuff. Like, it's just better in general. We're really happy. But obviously, nothing taken away from Arkell Snakey because he's a great player himself. But yeah, pretty happy, man.
What do you think that you've lost from the side after losing Arkell? And what do you think you've gained out of 2Foxy in terms of, like, in-game play styles?
In-game play styles, I was kind of leading our team with Arkell. I was the decision maker sort of thing, but Perry's kind of come along and took that role from me on this team. Obviously, we all have a bit of input and whatnot, but his Halo knowledge is really good. Like, he's obviously been competing a long time, he's played all the games, it goes back, so he just knows, like, a lot more about the game in general, and, like, he's telling me what he knows, we're telling him what he knows, and we're just getting better and better, basically.
Brian, I've got two questions. First things first, is that the Eiffel Tower or is it Blackpool Tower behind you in that photo over your shoulder?
Oh, that's the Eiffel Tower, mate. It's an old photos of me and my family.
that's actually really nice, actually. That's quite nice that he's got that behind him. My second question is, I'm checking on fantasy stats, like, all the time. Checking that you're on my team, by the way. Shout out to you. You always get me the points. But I got to say, it seems like every single week, you perform way better on day one when you're on our official broadcast versus on day two. Do you think, is it because you're hitting the big time on the official Halo stream, or is it because, like, what's the whole point of you going huge on day one but not on day two?
I don't know, man. I really like being on stream. Like, I'm a big fan of it myself. Like, it's more hype, and obviously with the official Halo channel as well, we've got everybody watching, whatnot. I don't know, man. I just like being in. Like, I'm planning on streaming tomorrow myself for the game. So I don't know. Day one, I just seem to, with a big Halo stream, I seem to do a lot better. Day two, it's still good, but I'm planning on going big day two, well, tomorrow as well. So
fantastic, right, Brandon? First of all, then, I want to say congratulations. You've obviously solidified yourself in the grand finals at the LAN event here in Leicester. Couple of things then. First of all, obviously you're talking about streaming. We know you've streamed before in the past back in MCC. You're getting on the stream grind now. If people want to follow you on Twitter, if people want to follow you on the stream, where do they need to be looking?
Well, my Twitter is Brandon Stones, just my name. I know it's got nothing to do with my gamer tag, but that's me on Twitter. And my Twitch, I'm currently only streaming through the Xbox at the minute, so it's not really the greatest of streams, but eventually I do plan on getting a computer, face cam, song request, like, good capture card, just everything in general. I want to go all out and just start doing it full time, so I hope people will, obviously, once eventually I do, just start getting involved.
Hopefully the gameplay makes up for the accent, because us northerners have to stick together. Right, Brandon, we're just about to let you go, but I need to ask you one question, okay? We knew what happened back at EMEA's. We're not going to discuss on it many more. I know you personally, we've discussed this one. Obviously, back at Halo 4 Global Championships, you qualified at the age of 17, but unfortunately the age of 18 was there. Is this the team that gets you to America and gets you to the Halo World Championship?
Yeah, 100%. I mean, obviously Moses being in the same boat with me. I mean, the fire is fueled now. I mean, there's nothing stopping us. This team, all really great players, especially when we, individually as well, we win our battles. Once we get the teamwork's like set out 100%, it's just going to be unstoppable, man. So I'm really, really confident, and we're getting to America with this team, 100%.
Fantastic stuff. Right, we've got to leave it there. Brandon, I want to say thank you very much and good luck. Obviously, you have made it anyway, but I'm sure you want to get to this finals completely undefeated. We've got day two tomorrow, and then we got the last final weeks. Thanks again, Brandon, and good luck.
Thanks for the fantasy points, Brandon.
No worries, man.
Incredible stuff. And I just want to highlight what he says, and I've spoken to him personally. The fire is fuel. This boy has been let down time and time again. Not let down, sorry, but kind of just fallen at the last hurdle, getting to the world champs, getting out to America for global champs. And I honestly think, and I still stand by this, the Dignitas mess up, what happened at EMEAs, is still the best thing what happened to him and Moz, because now they want this more than ever. I don't know what your thoughts are.
I mean, what I think is crazy is that rewind a few years with Halo 4, when Respectful and Moz were just online kids playing FFA, and everyone was like, oh, these guys are garbage, they're only good online. Now they're teaming with the likes of 2Foxy, who was probably saying, these guys are garbage, they're only online kids. So it shows how far they've come. Like you said, there's definitely fuel to the fire. These guys have got so much passion, so much desire.
Oh, I've just remembered, because it's still even worse. Sorry to break you off there, but the Battle of Europe, he missed out for Season 1 finals as well back at HCS. This is like three attempts now he's kind of made to get there.
Yep.
These boys want it, man. So badly.
Yep.
There's a lot of passion. But I think we're going to jump straight into a break now, guys. We'll be coming back with the second series of the night. I want to ask you all to keep it here. Some more fantastic, fantastic Halo action to come up with some new rosters just after the transfer period. Keep it right here. Do not go anywhere. We'll be right back in just a minute.